Welcome, Berean, to a prophetic moment. One of the things I've missed during this time, I don't know about you, is the inability to go into the store and to buy new clothes. There's something about getting new clothes that makes us feel so good about ourselves. We almost feel like a new person sometimes when we have a new jacket, a new shirt, a new pair of shoes. And wearing clothes can speak a lot of things. It tells people your mood. It tells them, you know, your inner thoughts, your feelings sometimes. We express it on what we wear. Clothes can also tell you what somebody does. We see a lot of medical clothing right now. We see people in scrubs. We see, you know, doctors in their, you know, surgical gear. It tells us what they do. But clothes in the Bible were very important. In fact, the Bible has a lot to say about it. God was very specific when he ordered the clothes for Aaron and the Levites in the tabernacle. And of course, Joseph was given a coat of many, many colors that really told of the favoritism that he had with his own natural father, but it spoke prophetically of what he would do in the future as second command of all Egypt. The prodigal son was given a robe, and that robe was symbolic of him no longer being a slave to sin. He was now accepted in the beloved, and he was now an honored son walking in all authority. Probably one of the most significant pieces of clothing mentioned in the Bible is a mantle. Well, we don't often use that term and say mantle, but what is a mantle? A mantle is a loose, sleeveless garment worn over your clothes or a cloak. Figuratively, a mantle symbolizes the preeminence of authority, accepting of leadership. It could be something that covers or enfolds or envelops, or it's an important role of responsibility. It represents that passes from one person to the other. And that's what I want to talk today about, a passing of a mantle, and in fact, new mantles. I believe within this pause, this quarantine that we're in, God is redirecting many things. We see that God is redirecting our country in many different ways, but God is speaking individually to each of us, redirecting us to take hold of some new mantles. But probably the most famous mantle is Elijah's mantle that was passed to Elisha. So let's go ahead and look at 2 Kings 2, 1 through 15. And it came to pass when the Lord was about to take up Elijah into heaven by a whirlwind, that Elijah went with Elisha from Gilgal. Then Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, please, for the Lord has sent me on to Bethel." But Elijah said, "As the Lord lives and as your soul lives, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. Now the sons of the prophets who were at Bethel came out to Elijah and said to him, "Do you know that the Lord will take away your master from over you today?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." And then Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, please, for the Lord has sent me on to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as your soul lives, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. Now the sons of the prophets who were at Jericho came to Elijah and said, "Do you not know that the Lord will take away your master from over you today?" And he answered, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, please, for the Lord has sent me on to Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as your soul lives, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on, and 50 men of the sons of the prophet went and stood facing them at a distance, while the two of them stood by the Jordan. Now Elijah took up his mantle, rolled it up, struck the water, and it was divided this way and that, so that two of them crossed over on dry ground. And so it was when they crossed over that Elijah said to Elisha, "Ask, what may I do for you before I am taken away from you?" Elijah said, "Please, let a double portion of your spirit be upon me." So he said, "You have asked a hard thing. Nevertheless, if you see me when I am taken from you, it shall be so for you. But if not, it shall not be so." Then it happened as they continued on in talk that suddenly a chariot of fire appeared excuse me, with horses of fire and separated the two of them. And Elijah went up in a whirlwind into heaven. And Elijah saw it and cried out, my father, the chariot of Israel and its horsemen. So he saw him no more. And he took hold of his clothes and tore them in two pieces. He also took up the mantle of Elijah that had fallen from him and went back and stood by the bank of the Jordan. Then he took the mantle of Elijah that had fallen from him and struck the water and said, where is the Lord God of Elijah? And when he also had struck the water, it was divided this way and that, and Elisha crossed over. Now when the sons of the prophets who were from Jericho saw him, they said, the spirit of Elijah rest on Elijah. You know, Elijah was a very tough mentor, wasn't he? He wasn't exactly that warm and fuzzy teacher that says, come see me after office hours and I will spend hours helping you figure this out. No, he was pretty tough, and he was like, you stay here, I'm going on. But thank goodness that Elijah was determined. He knew he had to stick with the man of God. If he was going to get the mantle, he had to be in approximation of that mantle. He couldn't leave the prophet. So he says, no, as the Lord lives, I'm going with you. So it's interesting, at three different places, the prophet tried to shake his protege. He tried to shake him. And that shows me that, you know, sometimes we need to be determined. I think God is looking within us, sort of that, you know, that sort of that determination. You're going to be like a bulldog that's hanging on to the bone, and you're not going to let go of the bone when it comes to the things that God has promised you. Too easy, we allow the things of the world and the things, you know, circumstances to try to shake us off what rightly belongs to us. But God's saying, hold fast. Be like Elijah, and you just keep your feet right behind the prophet, and you will inherit the mantle. But three places they went to that he tried to shake him. Gilgal. Gilgal means a wheel rolling. And I think one of the things that keeps us from getting into that new place that God's called us, that new level, is that we tend to be people of cycles. We do the same thing at the same time, at the same place, at, you know, same time, same bat channel, same place, around and around we go. We get into routines, and we sort of just plug away. God gives us something, and we don't ask if we should keep doing something. We just keep doing it, and we march on and march on and march on instead of listening and hearing from God. You know, Lord, where should I go from here? What should I do? And so we need to be determined to break out of cycles that we've gotten ourselves in. The second place is Bethel, which means house of God. And here the prophets came to heckle him. Talk about, don't you know, it's over. Don't you know you're going to lose your job today? Your master's leaving you. And I don't know about you, there's probably a lot of thoughts of fear that are trying to heckle us right now. What's going to happen to this economy? You're going to tank. You won't be able to feed your family. There's lots of fear circulating. And here those prophets, even though it says house of God, and the sons of the prophets came from the house of God, not always will you get the encouragement you're looking from the house of God. Sometimes, you know, those closest you can be your adversaries and not your cheerleaders. But, you know that God's called you to something, and there's a mantle that he wants you to take up. And so here he presses on, and he doesn't listen, and he moves forward. The third place is Jericho. And notice what he said to the prophets, too. He said what? Be silent. Sometimes you have to say to those thoughts that are swirling through your head, you're falling, you're failing. You need to, out of your mouth, say, be silent. Make those thoughts be quiet. Tell them to back off, you know, or out of here. I like sometimes you just say, scream no to those racing thoughts that come through your mind. Because listen, God's on your side. He hasn't left you. He has a plan for you. Hold fast to the Lord. So that third place is Jericho. And that word means fragrant, fragrant. All around him was doubt and unbelief. You're going to be a nobody after today, Elijah. Because Elijah's going to heaven. You're going to be a nothing after today. And those are the thoughts that were coming. But instead of allowing that fragrance of unbelief, he allowed the fragrance of faith. Elijah gave off something. You know, we don't have to necessarily be swirled and affected by the things around us. Let's allow what's inside of us affect the circumstances that are around us. Don't allow those circumstances to press on you. It's time to press back with the glory of the Lord. Press back with the fragrance of God. Press back with the praise of Almighty God. And so it says here, ask, ask. He said ask, and that word means to demand. Listen, Elijah was trying to shake him off because Elijah needed to have that determination. He needed to have that fortitude to do what God called him to do. And he's saying, come on now, ask of me. Put a demand on the anointing that's inside of me and to receive from the Lord. Why? So Elijah could be famous? No. Elijah needed that double portion so that he could affect the world he lived in, so that people's lives could be changed and people would know that there was a God in Israel. And so he says, ask, make a demand on me. And so he asked for that double portion, that double portion. And of course, you know, when he saw the chariots of fire and he saw his mentor going up, and what fell? That mantle fell to the ground. Before he picks up the mantle, do you know what he does symbolically? He rips his own clothes because he no longer was going to be the servant and the protege. He didn't need these clothes anymore. Like Superman, he's ripping out of those clothes. No longer Clark Kent. He now was going to take on the mantle of the Lord of the double portion. And he took that mantle up and he did exactly as his mentor did. He swirls up that mantle. He strikes the Jordan and he claims, where is the God of Elijah? And just as it happened with Elijah, the waters were parted and Elijah came through on dry ground. And what did the sons of the prophets say? They bowed down before him and said, surely, surely, this spirit that was on Elijah has come upon Elijah. You know, this reminds me of Matthew 7, 7 and 8, and says, ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and it will be opened to you. That word ask means to crave, desire. In this time that you're home and you're spending a lot of maybe alone time, ask of God. If you have concerns, ask him whatever you have need of. He's your loving, kind, good Father. He says, listen, desire it. Ask and it shall be given. Seek and you find. Knock and the door is open. Be persistent. Be persistent. Hallelujah. And so here, as I said, that same spirit, he picked up that new mantle. I believe that God is doing a shifting right now. He's releasing new mantles in the earth. This is a new season. This is a new era that we're moving in. And we need some Elijahs to rise up. We need double now. We need double what we had before Corona. We need double blessings, double power, double speaking of the word, double prayers, double praise. You know, this is a season of the double for the church. We're doubling, tripling, quadrupling our output just being on the internet like this. But we need new mantles. But mantles are here. The Lord has given them. But who will take them up? Who will rip off the old and put on the new? I hope that's you. I know that Joseph, he had many coats. He had that coat of many colors. But he never wore the coat from the former phase of his life into the new thing that God called him. When Joseph left the pit, he didn't have his coat of many colors when he went to Potiphar's house. When he was in Potiphar's house, Potiphar's wife, remember, tried to entice him to sleep with her. And he refused. He ran out of the house. And what does the Bible have a need to tell us? What did she hold in his hand? His cloak. It was a symbol. He was leaving that phase of his life. So he left behind Potiphar's house clothing. When he was in the prison and he interpreted the dreams and he was finally remembered and he came out of the prison, what does the Bible tell us? He changed his clothes. He changed his clothes. And then he went into Pharaoh's household. And Pharaoh, of course, put a robe upon him and a ring upon his hand because he was going to be second command of all Egypt, his palace position. So let me tell you, don't wear your former clothes. When you are leaving that old face behind, that old ministry behind. That ministry of Elijah is over. We're stepping into the ministry of Elijah. Put on the new mantle and don't wear your former clothes again. In Matthew 4, it says this, Jesus was walking by the Sea of Galilee. He saw two brothers. They were Simon, whose other's name was Peter, and Andrew, his brother. They were putting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. Jesus said to them, follow me, and I will make you fish for men. At once, they left the nets and followed him. Those nets were a symbol of their old life of fishermen, and they left that old behind, and they followed Jesus. I believe God's calling some of you to follow Jesus in a new way. Some of you are going to have to leave old clothes and old mantles behind. We're going to have to leave behind, old things that we used to do in ministry, maybe old things in that we used to work with, and follow after Jesus to go into the new thing that he's called you to do. Some of you are going to end up in new positions. Some of you are going to end up in new fields of study. Some of you may end up going back to school at this time. Some of you will maybe start new careers that you've never did before. This is a season of change, but God will empower you. Elijah definitely became the new prophet of the land, but God gave him a mantle to complete the task of double portion. There's a new thing for you during this time of waiting in quarantine. There's a new pathway that God has opened up. And beyond that, God is asking us to do this. God is asking us all in this new time to leave nets and become fishers of men. Not only are we going to pursue the things that God's called us to, but let us preach the gospel with more fire than we ever have before and see the double portion filling the nets for the kingdom of God. God bless you. Until next time, for our prophetic moment, have a good day.